awesome to see everyone in person. I'm sure you heard that all day. But again, we just want to appreciate the fact that you came. Seeing real people is not something that I guess anyone is taking for granted these days. So that's awesome. So thanks so much for coming. My name is Leo Conrad. I'm a principal product manager inside the Azure Arc platform team. And I'm joined by Arnav.
Hi, I'm Arnav, and I'm a product manager working on Azure Arc, specifically Arc-enabled servers. Thanks so much for coming.
All right, so today's session is about secure, monitor, and govern server workloads across hybrid, multi-cloud, and Azure infrastructure. That was a mouthful. So today what we're going to cover is we're going to cover Azure Arc-enabled servers, a bit of Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes. We'll talk about how to get started, kind of everything in between. We have some cool and snazzy demos for you. So we're just going to go with that. Again, if you have any questions, we do have people online. Please scan the barcode, ask a question. We'll do our very best to answer those. And we also have people on the chat, our experts, our colleagues, that are going to help with moderating the questions. Okay? So like I mentioned, today we're going to cover Azure Arc-enabled infrastructure. We're going to talk about how do we go by and secure those Azure Arc-enabled servers, and how do we actually, what is the approach that we are taking for hybrid environments. We'll talk about observability. How do you go by and actually, you know, look at all these assets that you just Arc-enabled? Then we're going to wrap things up with governance, auto-manage, very exciting space. And we'll share with you some good stuff on how to get started and all that stuff. We're going to try something here. So best Azure Arc tweet or LinkedIn post, right? If you've been, you know, we've been following that space, and appreciate if you've been following me as well in that space, you know that my superpower is cookies. So I wanted to share that superpower with you. Best tweet, best LinkedIn post, hashtag Azure Arc, tag me. I'm going to select people to get some cookies. Those are good, all right? Those are Milanos. That's serious, all right? So I just want you to appreciate it. So best tweet, best LinkedIn post, let's go. All right, let's start with the obvious. This is not an acronym. I know that some of you may think it's an acronym, but it's not, okay? Azure Arc is really, the notion of Azure Arc is really about bridging resources, is about bringing IT assets, applications, hybrid infrastructure into the space of Azure, okay? So we just wanted to break the ice and make sure that you understand that this is not an acronym, so we all know what is the name of the product that we're actually talking about here, okay? Cool, let's start. So show of hands, and again, I usually don't do show of hands, but I'm gonna do show of hands, right? Azure Arc, you never heard of it. Pick up your hand. Who never heard about Azure Arc? Maybe some people in the back. So everyone knows what Azure Arc is all about. Awesome. All right, let's go. So Azure Arc is really the notion of bringing a control plane, right, and stretch that control plane outside of Azure. Okay, so what does that really mean? It means that when we started to develop Azure Arc, we really wanted to make sure that we're able to provide customers with a way to govern, to manage, to secure, to observe all these IT assets that they have outside of Azure and bring those into Azure. Azure is, you know, the operating system of Azure, some may say. I like to say it that way because it really kind of solidified the idea of taking that operating system, Azure Resource Manager, and stretch that across cloud and hybrid and edge, right, and multi-cloud. So that's one thing, right? How do we take servers and how do we take Kubernetes clusters, which is a very important concept, how do we bring those into our control plane and why do we actually do that? So that's what we're gonna talk about today. But the other piece of that, Azure Arc is really a bi-directional thing, right? It's not just about sucking those resources that are deployed outside of Azure and bring those into the control plane. It's also about being able to deploy Azure services outside of Azure, okay? On top of Kubernetes clusters, okay? So Azure Arc enables SQL managed instance, machine learning, application services, all those services today available to you in Azure. What we wanna do is we wanna make sure that you are able to deploy those services outside of Azure, okay? The reason that you wanna do that is for multiple reasons, right? Data sovereignty, latency, getting closer to the data, getting closer to the teams, right? So there's a lot of use cases around that, and today we're gonna focus a lot on the security, the governance, and the aspect piece. You know, Azure Arc was really designed with a non-disruptive state of mind. And what does that really mean beyond the buzzword that is non-disruptive, right? You know, if you're thinking about challenges that people have today, like, I think the number one challenge is besides the obvious security concerns and governance and all that, I think the number one challenge, especially in the IT world space, is the, you know, the amount of tools that are out there. You have like 10 tools to do the same job from different angles. It's ridiculous. And what we wanted to do, you know, besides the fact that I personally think that that's just too much, but we can't fight it. You know, we can't fight the fact that you have a lot of tools out there that are designed to do IT operations or you know, very fundamental IT work. So Azure Arc was designed in a way to complement that. We don't want to disrupt the way customers are working. We don't want to change the tools that they're using. All we're saying is that because you are invested in Azure, what you can do is you can leverage Azure APIs, toolchain, right? And you can basically apply those APIs, those operations on top of Azure Arc resources, okay? So that's really what we're talking about. We're talking about bringing IT assets and bring those into the control plane so you can actually go by and use things like Azure Policy and role-based access control and tagging and everything that is between so you can actually take advantage of the platform, the, you know, the hyperscaling of the platform that is Azure, and apply those on top of your IT assets that are deployed outside of Azure. Arnav?
Great. So now we're going to be talking about Azure management across cloud and edge. And to do this, we're going to be using a hypothetical customer. Now raise your hand if you have a mix of Windows and Linux workloads. Almost everyone in this room. Raise your hand if you have a mixture of Azure and on-prem workloads. Again, almost everyone in this room. Raise your hand if you have workloads running across multiple clouds. OK, again, almost every single hand up went up in this room. So based off of this, we've actually designed a hypothetical customer scenario. And we're going to be diving into their environment to showcase what Arc looks like in action. And so we're going to be looking at this customer Fabricam Residences. And Fabricam Residences has a mixture of Windows and Linux servers, VMs running within Azure. But then recently, they acquired Alpine Ski Resort. And Alpine Ski Resort has a mixture of Windows and Linux workloads, as well as containerized workloads running on-prem and in another cloud. So all of a sudden, they have part virtualized, part containerized infrastructure running across multi-cloud, hybrid, and edge workloads. Now, this sounds great from a strategy perspective, but what about the management of this entire digital estate? That's where Azure Arc comes in. Through Azure Arc, you're able to take those servers on-prem in other clouds, clusters running on-prem or in other clouds, and project them into the Azure management plane so you can benefit from the same management tooling you use for your Azure VMs with your servers anywhere, the same tooling for AKS with your containers anywhere. And we're going to be seeing that in action with Fabricam Residences environment. So let's switch gears, and let's dive into the subscription group corresponding to Fabricam Residences and see an inventory view of their Arc-enabled servers and Kubernetes clusters. Let's put the Fab in Fabricam with Azure Arc. All right?
That's good.
I know. All right, take.
I had my doubts.
All right. All right. So right now, you can see the subscription group. And specifically, we're looking at Fabricam Residences resource group corresponding to Arizona. This is a real estate company. And so we're diving into one geography to keep it at a reasonable number of resources, right? Here we have our Arc-enabled Kubernetes clusters. And these are clusters sitting outside of Azure that have been projected into our Azure management plane. We have tagging right off the gate. We have the Azure VMs that I mentioned, Azure native resources. But you also have these Arc-enabled servers sitting there too, all consistently viewable. That's the inventory capability of Azure Arc in action. Now, obviously, I'm just showing this to you from Azure Portal, but you could leverage Azure Resource Graph to really query this at scale. Now, let's double-click on a specific resource, this newly onboarded Alpine Ski Arc Server AZ76, which, as you can see, is a little bit lonely without tags compared to all the other resources within the subscription group. So as you click on this Arc-enabled server, we can go ahead and edit, and we can go ahead and directly add tags, just like you would for any other resource. So here we're going to tag this as being in the state of Arizona. like all the other resources there, being in the city. We can pick any city in Arizona. Let's just go with Flagstaff because it's belonging to the Alpine Ski Resort and the company as Alpine Ski Resort. And voila, we can go ahead and save this. And we've just tagged this non-Azure server that's being projected into the Azure Management Plane, and we're going to be able to query it. Now, the inventory capability is just the tip of the iceberg. You also get visibility into extensions being deployed. So just like with our Azure VMs, you can deploy VM extensions. Arc-enabled servers support extension management. So you can deploy extensions at ease using Azure Policy, ARM, CLI, even Azure Portal. And so here we have the Azure Monitor Agent extension deployed for this Arc-enabled server. We'll be able to click and automatically remediate as well. So this just encapsulates a very high level of some of the inventory capabilities you're benefiting from with Azure Arc.
All right. Do we have the script?
Oh, let's do take.
All right. We're back.
We're back. All right. Perfect.
So here's the money shot, right? Arnav talked about the notion of tags. He talks about the notion of inventory management. And why do we show you this busy slide? There is a reason behind this. You know, the number one use case that we're seeing from customers when they are talking to us about Azure Arc-enabled servers is really the notion of security, compliance, governance at scale. That's the number one use case, hands down, right? The reason that we wanted to show you this slide is to talk about the art of the possible, okay? And what are the options that you have? You know, when it comes to compliance, the number one thing, the fundamental step that you need to take is first things first, to understand what you have in your inventory. That's what Arnav just showed you, right? You saw a bunch of Azure VMs, you saw a bunch of Azure Arc-enabled servers, Kubernetes clusters. That's your inventory. And then you put in some tag sprinkles on top of that. But why do we actually go by and do that? The reason that you want to do that is because you want to be able to create an environment that you have full control of, no matter where those assets are deployed. So the slide that you see here really illustrates the notion of building compliance for different set of resources, different set of use cases, different set of governance and compliance requirements, right? So that's why you see here four examples for different compliance, basically compliance policies that are out there in the wild, right? GDPR, NHS, HIPAA, all these compliance policies that we have out there, those are real requirements that are coming from customers. Now, because you're Arc-enabling those assets, right? In this case, you're seeing Azure Arc-enabled servers, but that can apply to any Azure Arc resource. But because you are Arc-enabling those resources, you basically be able to deploy Azure Policy, right? And later on, Arnav is going to talk about something even stronger than just thinking about Azure Policy. But how do you go by and create those policy bundles against group of resources? How do you actually go by and do that? So this is where Azure Arc fits in, right? Because what you can do is you can create a mental connection between what you have on premises or in other clouds, doesn't really matter, and what you have in Azure, and mix those together or gel those together into a single unified group of resources. Now, once you have that, all the things that you have at the top, right, are available to you. All the goodies that Azure Resource Manager has to offer. So he talked about the extension notion, right? So we're going to talk about Microsoft Cloud Defender and Monitor, and everything that is in between is available to you against those assets because, and you know, again, please remember that term. They are first-class citizen inside our API. That's what it means, really. So that means that those assets now can benefit out of ARM. And on the far left, what you're seeing on the top left is those tool chain that I was referring to before, right? The fact that we don't want to be disruptive in the way that we are approaching this. We want people to use the same tools that they are familiar with Azure against or, you know, with those Azure Arc-enabled resources, all right? So that was really important to mention. Arnav?
Yeah. So it looks like I'm trying to put the fab in Fabricam, but Lior just put the arc in architecture. Now we're going to showcase some Defender for Cloud capabilities, and we're going to be drilling into this in the demo environment. But again, what Lior mentioned, Arc-enabled resources are first-class citizens within our security posture management capabilities. So when it comes to Defender for Cloud, across its cloud security posture management and cloud workload protection capabilities, whether that's the continuous assessment with the high-level secure score, that's going to incorporate not just your Azure resources, but your resources in other clouds, your on-prem infra, across its kind of Windows and Linux mix, across containerized and virtualized workloads. So you have that continuous assessment that's going to encapsulate not just your Azure native resources, but your Arc-enabled resources too, in a really native way. Then from a securing and defending perspective, you'll see alerting and recommendations like through the Azure Security Benchmark. And again, this extends across Azure and non-Azure infra through Arc. And then finally, when it comes to alerting, you can use the same alerting framework across Azure and non-Azure through Arc. So what we really see is the core kind of value prop of Defender for Cloud really integrating in a native way to afford extensible security and compliance story. And we're going to see that in action for Fabricam residences, representative of what a day-to-day might look like for a SOC that might be struggling with this IT sprawl. Finally, I just wanted to very briefly touch on Microsoft Sentinel, because this also incorporates Arc-enabled resources in a very similar native way. So Arc-enabled servers, you can deploy AMA extension for monitoring and data log collections, and you can leverage the data collection afforded by Microsoft Sentinel, as well as all of the customized visualization capabilities, the detection capabilities, the multi-cloud hunting capabilities, and the orchestrated and automated response capabilities as well. So really with Sentinel, you're going to be able to seem like you're soaring, you know, with the security information event management and security orchestration automated response with its native Arc integration. But let's see this really in action for Defender for Cloud in the Fabricam residences. All right, so switching gears into a demo. Are folks able to see my screen?
Yep.
Good. All right. So right here, we have top line, we have security posture. Again, as I mentioned, this security posture, this looks really simple, but this is an observable, high-level overview of the security posture across not just your Azure resources, but your Arc-enabled resources sitting in other clouds and on-prem as well. You'd be able to drill down into regulatory compliance. And again, this looked like it's just Azure resources, but under the hood, this is all of your Arc-enabled infrastructure as well. Similarly, when it comes to your workload protection, you're getting alerting, and fortunately in this case, not too many malicious alerts, across not just your Azure, but your Arc-enabled infra as well. So let's really double-click into the inventory view, for example. So here, we have a bunch of the Azure VMs, as I was mentioning, but we also have our Arc-enabled servers right here. So for example, let's just pick this Alpine Ski Arc Server 4. We have prioritized recommendations, and we're getting this for a resource, a server that's sitting outside of Azure that's been Arc-enabled. And we even have point-and-click fix for some of these prioritized recommendations. So for example, it's saying file integrity monitoring should be enabled on the machines. We actually have direct remediation steps right here and the ability to point-and-click and address that right here, right now. Stepping back into Defender for Cloud, we also have visibility into workload protection, extending across Azure and Arc-enabled resources, as well as the ability to drill into regulatory compliance. So for example, we can go into ISO 27001 standards or SOC TSP standards, and we'll get visibility into which criteria are being met or not met. We can view compliance over time, visualizing using Azure Monitor, and we can even download and create on-demand reporting, which might be helpful for someone like a SOC analyst, where they're struggling to generate that compliance reporting at scale and at ease across their Azure and non-Azure resources all at the same time. So this really typifies, as we kind of walk through the security piece, what it might look like for Fabricam residences in action. Now I'll give it to Lior, who's going to at the helm of the Defender for Container Security piece as well.
So, you know, one important thing to realize as we are, as we are talking about this is really the notion of extensibility, right? What you're seeing right now is part of the overarching notion of the extensibility model that sits on top of Azure Arc, right? Whether it's Azure Arc enabled servers with the extensions that we talked about, or Azure Arc enabled Kubernetes, and all these extensions, all these, you know, this motion of let's extend, you know, what you have on premises and bring that or use or leverage what we have in Azure is really important to understand when it comes to the value proposition of Azure Arc and where does that fit into your universe. So Arnav really covered Azure Arc-enabled servers. Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes, in that sense, is really an interesting one because it sits really in the middle of the infrastructure and the services. Remember, we talked about the bidirectional thing that is Azure Arc. You have Azure Arc-enabled infrastructure, which is bringing assets into the control plane, but you also have Azure Arc-enabled services, which means that you're able to deploy services outside of Azure. So Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes really sits in the middle of that, because Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes is the foundation for deploying services, right? So if you want to deploy SQL managed instance or application services, you need Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes. But even before you're actually thinking about this, how do you do the basic stuff? How do you do the fundamental things that you need to do on against Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes clusters in the notion or in the connection to this compliance story or security story that we're talking about? So to show you what I mean is I'm going to go here to, we're going to come back to the resource group. If Azure will let me, you know what, let's do that from here. And come back to the resource group. So we talked about, you know, Azure Arc-enabled servers, and let's just save some real estate here. We talked about Azure Arc-enabled servers. That's all the servers that you're seeing right here. But we also have a couple of Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes clusters, right? So those Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes clusters are deployed outside of Azure. They're actually deployed with Rancher K3S distribution, which is a CNCF component certified distribution of Kubernetes, and those are Arc-enabled. Now, let's talk for a second about what is it that you can see. Really, the basic stuff. There is so much to uncover when it comes to Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes, but this is for a different session when we're going to talk, you know, when we can talk about all the things that you can do with that. But let's just touch on the basic stuff for a second. First things first, obviously, as you can see, you can get the metadata of the Kubernetes cluster, so you understand what, you know, what is that Kubernetes cluster that you have there. So you can see K3S. I hope everyone can see that. K3S, and we have the tags and all that. So we talked about this extensibility model. So if I'll go to extensions here, and remember, Arnav showed you the same view for Azure Arc-enabled servers and extension. If I'll go to extensions here, you can see that I have actually three extensions deployed against that cluster. I have Azure Monitor for containers, okay? That's containers insights. We also have Microsoft Defender for Kubernetes, and we also have Azure Policy. We'll talk about Azure Policy in a second here, right? So first thing first, let's go and look at insights. So in insights, what I'm able to do, because I have that extensions, I'm actually able to see and get some visibility to that cluster. Now, that cluster is pretty flatbread, right? Nothing really happens on that cluster. But let me show you a very interesting view that you're getting here. So let's save some real estate and bring this up. So what is it that we're seeing here? What we're seeing here is basically the inventory of that cluster. Now, I want you to take a second and think about it. What we're able to do is we're able to take a cluster, a Kubernetes cluster that is deployed outside of Azure, and actually be able to have eyes into that cluster, right, without doing anything besides Arc enabling that cluster and install that extension for container insights. So that's number one. And like I mentioned, this is really the start of this story of governance, compliance at scale. So that's number one. Arnav also talked about Microsoft Defender, right? Microsoft Defender for cloud, that's obviously also available for Arc-enabled Kubernetes and Kubernetes in general in Azure. So we'll come back to the resource group. I'll go here to security. We'll open the security center. So this, you know, this cluster is already Arc-enabled, okay? So if I'll go here, view additional recommendation, we can see that I'm getting the security posture, and I hope the, you know, I'm not seeing the screen there, but I hope the resolution is okay. But what we're able to see here is basically the security posture of that Kubernetes cluster, okay? And I can drill down to each and every one of those. Now, one important thing to realize is that those Azure policies, or sorry, those Defender policies or Defender postures that are applied against those Kubernetes clusters, those are also available to you with Azure Kubernetes Service, okay, AKS. So that means that you have a unified way to look at Kubernetes clusters, AKS, and Arc-enabled Kubernetes clusters, the same way as Arnav showed you with Azure VMs and Azure Arc-enabled servers. And again, I'm coming back to this connectivity point, which is not being disruptive in the way that we are operating.
All right. Well, are folks able to see? All right. So as we just started touching on, With Azure Arc, you're able to monitor workloads across heterogeneous infrastructure. And so we just started getting a taste of that with Container Insights. But we also have, analogously, on the Arc-enabled server side and Azure VM side, VM Insights, where you're able to monitor the performance and health of your Arc-enabled server and VMs. And we're going to be showcasing this insight view just in a moment. And so we want to highlight that, you know, you get this level of granularity of performance analytics, but also the customization across workbooks, dashboarding, logging that you can do on your own, in addition to this kind of data foundation being collected. So we're going to be showcasing some pieces that are out of the box, but there's a world of what you can do on top of the observability capabilities afforded by Azure Monitor. And so this kind of goes into the analogous piece on the container site with Container Insights. So let's get after it, and we're going to go right into the demo environment again, and we're going to see observability in action for Fabricam REST instances. All right. So are folks able to see? Awesome. So here we have that Alpine Ski Arc server AZ4 again, our favorite server. We've been picking on it all day. We can go into Insights. And as we go into Insights, we can go and double-click on Performance. And in this Performance view, we're going to have really granular analytics in terms of logic disk performance, CPU utilization, memory over time, logic disk IOPS, et cetera. And so here we actually have this one particular Arc-enabled server. But what's going on under the hood? We've actually configured this with a monitoring configuration where we've used the Azure Monitor agent, and we've actually created a data collection rule. And with data collection rules, or DCRs, you really get the control to granularly send specific pieces of data to our log analytics workspace where we're analyzing this at scale. So now let's zoom out into the overall monitor view, right? So we're zooming out into the monitor view. We saw one Arc-enabled server. But what's going on across the entire environment, right? Well, let's go into that performance view. And here, what's super neat is we're going to be seeing the CPU utilization across Azure VMs and Arc-enabled servers all from one pane of glass. So here we have, you know, different servers sitting outside of Azure and within Azure, all of them being projected into this same CPU utilization perspective. And similarly, from a mapping view, we can double-click there too, and we'll be able to get in kind of insight map view as well, in terms of the different processes and their relationships as well. And we would be able to double-click on their interrelationships as well as their traffic being sent between them. Now, what happens from a learning perspective? We can not just analyze this data retroactively, but we can go proactive. We can actually create our own alert rules. So for example, I could go here to alert rules, and you know, in this Fabricam REST instances, I can pick just Arc servers, for example. And I can pick, I'll continue picking on Alpine Ski Arc server AZ4. I guess it's not its day today. And
I'm really abusing it.
Yeah. And then I'll, let's say, you know, we want to get alert. Every time there's any administrative operations on it all, we want to get alert. Make sure no administrator is bullying this resource. And we're going to be setting this event logic, and we'll go ahead and next in actions. And we can simply select an action group. So for example, here I'm picking the Fabricam action group. And this is going to email every ARM owner of that environment. And then we can go ahead and review and create. Oh, and we can obviously give it a name. We can call it Alpine Alert 1. Very creative naming right there. And we can go ahead and create that. And that typifies a sort of proactive approach you can take using the same data foundation with Azure Observability. So with that, we want to switch gears and go into the final piece, because you know we said secure, monitor, and govern, so you have to get to govern. So we're going to go to the govern piece right ahead. All right. Are folks able to see? Perfect. So now let's talk about the governance angle and the governance and management capabilities across your heterogeneous compute. So for here, I want to really highlight the capabilities of Azure AutoManage Machine Configuration. So some of you might be familiar with guest config or DSC. Raise your hand. All right, a really large number of people in the room for those of us who are attending virtually. So with Azure AutoManage Machine Configuration, we actually just generally made this available recently. You have the ability to apply configuration settings in machines, both through built-in and custom packages. And this includes not just auditing, but remediation capabilities. What's super neat about this is actually baked into the connected machine agent that's powering Azure Arc-enabled servers. So if you're familiar with Azure VMs, you need to enable this as a guest configuration extension. But with Arc-enabled servers, guest configuration is actually a component of the agent, so you can audit or configure OS settings basically as code, and this extends across your Azure VMs and Arc-enabled servers. You can do this at a per-server level or at scale through Azure Policy, like I'll be showing you in just a moment, and you can get clear visibility into the compliance status with the ability to actually remediate point and click again, because we know you love that. So let's actually get after it and see Azure Auto Manage machine configuration in action with some of our Arc-enabled servers. All right. So now we're back into our view. And let's go into Azure Arc. And let's go into our Arc-enabled servers. And why don't we pick on a new server now? Let's pick on Alpine Ski Arc Server AZ6, which was that server in the beginning that we recently onboarded that was missing those tags, right? And so we can go ahead, and in our machine configuration view, we see that we've actually already applied some Azure policies that have machine configuration under the hood that are auditing right off the bat. We have, for example, this Windows baseline, and we're able to view its non-compliance at scale. Now, if we wanted, we could actually go ahead and double-click, and we could create our own custom configuration. So it's not just that we get this clarity and visibility into our compliance status in these guest OS level settings, but we could create a custom configuration using DSC and PowerShell. But we won't be doing that just yet. Instead, we're going to be using an Azure policy to apply to this Arc-enabled server. And again, this is a server sitting outside of Azure, and we're going into guest OS level settings through policy. So why don't we go ahead and assign a policy. And so we're going to apply it actually across the resource group. And here I'm going to pick a dyn policy. That's deploy if not only exists, a dyn policy. And you know, I know this audience loves their food for thought. Let it sink in. All right. So we're going to be using the TLS policy right here. And that's going to be configuring secure communication protocols on Windows servers. We can go ahead and select that. And what's so neat is we can actually go ahead and actually ensure that that applies to not just our Azure VMs, but our Arc-enabled servers as well. We're making sure that TLS policy is going to be fixed. And we're going to create the auto remediation capability as well. We're going to be creating a corresponding remediation task using a system-managed identity. Now, that's really granular level governance that we're able to do point-and-click at scale through Azure policy and get visibility into. Then we can go ahead and create that. And here we've created an Azure policy that's going to be using machine configuration under the hood with our Arc-enabled servers at scale. And so we have some other servers in this environment as well, like Alpine Ski Arc Server AZ4, where we've applied some configurations already. And we can see other examples of guest configuration or machine configuration policies, such as setting the Windows time zone. And here we have a Windows server sitting outside of Azure that's been Arc-enabled. And we have visibility into the fact that you know, we've configured it with the proper time zone, which in this case is West US. And that can be a challenge for Fabricam residences, which is you know, multinational in this case. So that showcases just kind of the tip of the iceberg in terms of some of the governance capabilities afforded with machine configuration. But as we switch gears, you know, we've covered a lot of different capabilities, right? We covered security, we covered monitoring, we covered governance, and we covered what sounds and feels like, raise your hand if that felt like a laundry list of Azure services we covered. Okay. Fewer hands. I think a lot of you guys are shy on that one. But that was quite a few Azure services we covered. So the question is, how do you onboard all of these Azure services at scale for your Arc-enabled server or your Azure VM? It's quite difficult to manually discover and identify exactly which Azure service you should need to set up, how to set that up. And then once you've set up that Azure service, what if there's drift, right? You guys are familiar with drift. What if there's issues with the configuration of that service? Well, this is where Azure Auto Manage Machine Best Practices comes into the picture. With Azure Auto Manage Machine Best Practices, which just announced its general availability today, you'll actually have the capability to onboard an Arc-enabled server to a set of Azure services at once. And you can pick exactly which Azure services you want. So some of them are outlined here. We have configuring a log analytics workspace, VM Insights, update management, an automation account, just to name a few. With Azure Auto Manage Machine Best Practices, you can intelligently onboard to these services. And this will configure guest OS per Azure Security Benchmark configurations as well. You're going to have the flexibility to really customize those configuration profiles. So you can pick just which services you want, or you can use dev test and built-in production profiles as well. So you can follow the cloud well-architected framework and really deliver the best of Azure services. And this is across your Azure VMs and Arc-enabled servers and your mix of Windows and Linux servers. The other really neat thing is it's actually going to automatically detect if there's any drift and correct it when it's detected, that drift, with those Azure services that you're interested in leveraging. And finally, there's this range of experiences you can use to onboard to it. So there's obviously point and click with Azure Portal, but you can also go into PowerShell. You can use the Azure Policy to deploy Auto Manage at Scale, or you could use an ARM template. So there's a lot of flexibility in the way that you can onboard to Auto Manage. And what's really neat is you can onboard a server to Azure Arc, and you can onboard it to Auto Manage, and you can couple that together. So then you benefit from not just onboarding it to Arc and then having that resource that we can tag, but actually starting from day one to use those Azure services you're interested in across security, monitoring, and governance with your Arc-enabled server. So enough of the spiel. Let's get into the Fabricam Residences environment, which you guys by now know and love, and see AutoManage in action. All right. Switching gears. Are folks able to see? Perfect. So here, we're going to double-click on a server that actually has an auto-managed configuration profile being applied. And it will note this is a Linux server, actually. And so when we go into auto-manage, we've actually already applied a configuration profile, and we get visibility into the fact that it's conformant. And so this is one particular server where we've applied auto-manage machine best practices. And this is actually a custom profile. And in this custom profile, we've enabled auto-manage machine configuration, which, by the way, is by default part of machine best practices. It's a very native integration with DSE under the hood, right? So we've applied that, and we can have visibility into the conformant status of this auto-managed profile for this Arc-enabled server. But let's zoom out and see auto-manage in action across these multiple machines, right? We've actually onboarded several different machines here, right? Different Arc-enabled servers into different configuration profiles, you'll notice, right? Different configuration profiles, different sets of services depending on what we need. And we have visibility into their conformant status across the board, so we can drill in to make sure that they have just the Azure services we want. Now, as I mentioned, there was Alpine Ski Arc Server AZ76, which was the newly onboarded server that actually we haven't assigned any auto-manage machine best practices configuration profile on quite yet. So we can go ahead and actually enable on an existing machine. And here I want to showcase that's not just the custom profile, there's actually built-in prod and dev test profiles as well. So why don't we pick a custom profile for this one? Let's pick our handy custom profile that we already have. And we're going to pick the Fabricam auto-manage machine configuration profile. Then machines, we can go ahead and select. And we're going to select in particular that new Alpine Ski Arc AZ6 server, review and create, and validate, very important step. And voila, we've applied an Azure auto-manage machine configuration best practices profile. So that's going to automatically onboard that Arc-enabled server to Azure services on demand. What's really neat is, you know, here we just show a handful of limited configuration profiles, but it's so easy to create your own custom configuration profiles as well. So today we saw a range of, you know, security, monitoring, governance capabilities. Why don't we create our own Fabricam Residences configuration super profile? Feeling adventurous at calling it super profile. And we'll put it in this same resource group, same region, and let's enable a lot of different things. Let's enable machine insights monitoring, machine configuration, update management, change tracking, Cloud Defender, automation account, log analytics workspace, just a range of Azure services that you'd have to individually onboard to. Now it's going to handle onboarding to all of those at ease. And this is for a server that's outside of Azure. Now that's really what Lior was alluding to with, you know, Azure Arc creating first-class citizens out of non-Azure resources and really simplifying the experience. So with that, we've created a custom configuration profile, we've shown the conformant status, we've applied it to a server, and we've also seen that, you know, I'm using Portal to do all this. You could do this with policy. You could do this with ARM. You can do this with CLI. So there's really flexibility in terms of the tooling of choice in terms of doing this. But I hope it's crystal clear by now, really the power of Arc Server coupled with AutoManage in terms of really delivering the best of Azure services to, you know, servers not just in Azure, but really anywhere through this customer, Fabricam Residences. All right.
So we covered a lot. Sorry, we covered a lot, right? But I want you to remember what we talked about in this space of how do you go by and bundle things that you don't control, okay? So let's just say that, you know, you're running an internal IT business. You have a lot of departments. You have a lot of businesses inside that big business. How do you go by and basically create those bundling of governance postures? Policy, AutoManage, all this stuff, right, are vessels to do that. Azure Arc is really the enable. That's really the foundation of that. All the things that come on top of that, that's what really makes it so powerful. So I think we come a full circle, and we covered a lot of things, and I think that the only thing that is left is just kind of share with you what are the assets that you have to get started today. Who heard about the Azure Arc Jumpstart project? All right. I was expecting more, but that's okay. That's fine. All right, so we have a lot of resources, and let's just kind of share with you kind of my perspective on this. You know, when we are thinking about Microsoft Docs, when we're thinking about how do we go by and provide customers, our own field, partners, a way to kickstart, a way to jumpstart their experience, we're pointing them to Microsoft Docs, which is a great asset, right? The thing with Azure Arc is that, if you already understand that by now, is that by definition, Azure Arc touches everything that is outside of Azure. It does not apply to the native resources that you have in Azure. Azure Arc is irrelevant for Azure VMs. It's irrelevant for AKS clusters, right, in that sense, right? It is relevant to AKS cluster, but that's a different topic. But generally speaking, Azure Arc is really designed to touch the assets that are outside of Azure. So the way to build basically collateral content, a way for you to get started, we created a project about 3 years ago called the Azure Arc Jumpstart. The Azure Arc Jumpstart really provides you with scenario-based automation in order for you to spin up environments in an automated fashion without touching your infrastructure. So that means that you are able to build sandboxes inside your infrastructure in order for you to get started. So as of today, we have more than 120 automated scenarios. And those scenarios are really designed for you to work on your Google infrastructure or your VMware infrastructure or EC2 instances or just bare metal, right? And also simulate things in Azure, okay? So that's really important to understand. We're providing you with those automated scenarios in order to you to bootstrap those environments and also providing day two unified operation scenarios on top of that. So things like what Arnav showed you with AutoManage, with Policy, Insights, Defender, all this stuff are part of the Jumpstart and are available to you today, so you can go and check that out. We also have RBox, okay? RBox is really a superset of scenarios. If you're thinking about those individual scenarios, what we did with RBox is basically combine multiple scenarios into a single unit deployment, automated one, in order for you to bootstrap everything inside an Azure subscription. So all you need is an Azure subscription, you're deploying everything in the resource group, and as of today, we have 4 RBox flavors. RBox Full, which will give you all the breadth of Azure Arc, RBox for IT Pros, which really focus on Azure Arc-enabled servers, RBox for DevOps, which focus on Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes, and announced today, Azure Arc-enabled RBox for Data Ops, which focus on Azure Arc-enabled data services and specifically for SQL Managed Instance. In addition to that, we also announced today HCI Box, public preview. HCI Box is really your way to spin up a full-blown HCI environment in a nested fashion inside your subscription so you can go by and test things, POC, without waiting for hardware to arrive, especially as of, you know, today with long lead times and, you know, supply chain challenges. So HCI Box was announced today, public preview, go check it out. And Jumpstart Lightning, when we are basically bringing people like yourself into the show and talk to them about their experience, making sure that it's not just us that are talking about this, it's also hearing from the people that, the boots on the ground, how I like to call it, right? The people that are actually need to maintain those. And by the way, for those of you that are, you know, IT admins, VMware admins, operators and all that, in my book, you're all heroes. I know what it means. I know what it means to keep the lights on, okay? And that's really what we're trying to provide with when it comes to the Jumpstart, Azure Arc, and everything is between. So to wrap things up, we also have a couple more resources. Obviously, Microsoft Docs is the obvious one, and we also have landings on accelerators. Those are part of the Cloud Adoption Framework, and they will give you basically the best practices, the design guidance, all the recommendations that you need in order to go by and build Azure Arc-enabled servers environment, Azure Arc-enabled Kubernetes environments, and Azure Arc-enabled SQL managed instance environments. With that, Arnav, thank you so much.
Great, thank you so much.
And thank you, everyone. Have a great Ignite. Awesome to see you in person, really.
Thank you so much.